stars, of course, here at Dubawi, Golden Horn, and also New Approach. Fantastic horses, classic winners, and Group 1 winners who've really made their name worldwide. And here they are, siring champions, and this is the home of it. Well, the breeding season doesn't start for a couple of months yet, so they'll be resting up, but they'll be very, very active come February. And who knows, we might see a few more champions by those horses in the future. Now today we've asked you to get in touch with us here at Godolphin. We really want your questions. So anything at all, Twitter, Facebook, emails, anything at all, get in touch with us. And we've got a couple of the big Godolphin personalities to join us and to answer those questions for you today. Let's go inside and meet them here in the Godolphin office. And two personalities who I know you're very, very familiar with, the two Godolphin jockeys here in the UK, William Buick, first of all. Will, good to see you.
Good morning, Jim.
And James Doyle.
Good morning, Jim. How are
you? So, here we are. We're sitting here at the end of 2017. It's been a very, very eventful year, and I think we're going to reflect on a few of the major points, the major incidents, major highlights, if you like, of the year. First of all, William, what do you think for you was the I know you had a down point, which we'll come to in a moment, but the absolute highlight for you?
I don't really like to single out one highlight, Jim, but you know, certainly one of the highlights were that, you know, my main stable in Charlie Appleby, if you like, the horses held their form all season, and you know, everyone knows it's a long and hard season in the UK and Europe, and worldwide really. So the horses haven't held their form for so long was a real credit to the team behind it all in the stables and in the yard. And you know, if you,
I think that was New Approach, by the way.
Yeah, it sounds like it. But if I was going to pick a personal highlight for myself, it was probably winning the Breeders' Cup Filly Med Turf on Wahida in Delmar for a few various reasons, really. Of course, it's very special to win the Breeders' Cup, and you know, under the circumstances, haven't had the enforced mid-season break, and on a filly so as special as Wahida, of course, being a homebred by Dubawi as well. So, you know, on all levels, that was very special.
Right, well, we'll come to that enforced mid-season break in a moment. But James, what about your season? You were riding winners left, right and centre.
No, I was lucky enough to get on some nice horses, and you know, had a good Royal Ascot, which is pretty key to your season. You know, if you have managed to get a couple of Group 1 winners there, it sets you up nicely. And I suppose a highlight would have to be Barney Roy winning at Ascot, the St James's Palace. It was a pretty breathtaking performance, and to break the track record the way he did just shows what a horse he was.
Well, both of you were connected with absolute superstars, you with Ribchester and you with Barney Roy. First of all, what was Ribchester like as a rider? I mean, you've ridden many good horses now. How would he rate?
Look, he was a very, very exciting horse to ride. You know, early doors he was a bit unpredictable. But he really channeled all his energy in the right direction and really got it together as at the end of his two-year-old career and the beginning of his three-year-old career. And you know, obviously being by Ifraj, who I believe stands behind us as well, it made it extra special. And you know, James won Group 1s on him as well, so he was a horse that, you know, I always believed he had enough pace to win over 6 furlongs at the highest level. I know he won the Mill Reef over, he won him in the Mill Reef over 6 furlongs as a two-year-old, but you know, when he was winning all the mile races last year and this year, he showed incredible pace, and you know, he was a miler out of the absolute top draw.
And James, what about Barney Roy? It always struck me that he was a horse who was very, very gutsy as well as being very brilliant.
No, exactly that. He had a fantastic attitude. Never say die. I mean, his performance in the Eclipse was unbelievable. The way, you know, Ulysses passed me going like he was going to go away and win easy, and you know, Barney really dug in and nearly collared him on the line. I think the main point with Barney was his length of stride. He covered the ground like no horse I've ever ridden before. He had an extraordinary stride and stroke the ground almost. So, yeah, he was pretty special horse, and you know, he showed how brilliant he was that day in the St James's Palace.
Now, the downside, the bad day, Chicago, Arlington, August, you've had a fall just past the line. First of all, unusual having a fall past the line, isn't it, or just on the line?
Yeah, look, it was very unfortunate, and it was a very sad incident when you lose a horse. It's nothing worse.
The horse was Permian, wasn't it? Yeah.
You know, there's nothing worse in the sport and for everybody involved with the horse, you know. It was very sad, and you know I got plenty of support from His Highness and his family, so you know I was taken good care of right away, really, both medically and mentally, if you like, you know. So
when you're lying there, though, it must be very, very scary, isn't it? The first thing you think, well, you know,
it's painful.
Well, painful to start with, but also, do I feel everything? Because I mean, it was a neck injury, wasn't it?
It was a back injury. But look, it's everyone deals with those kind of things very differently. You kind of have to block it out in a way, really. And just have to look at the end picture when you're getting better, when you're back riding. That's what you work towards from the moment you lie there. But look, I can't thank enough people for the help they gave me, both in Chicago and both when I got back to Newmarket. And you know, like I said, his Highness and his family, they were great, gave me a lot of confidence. And you know, when you have that behind you, when you then go to the gym and you can eventually start stepping the exercise and the training up, you know, you really go for it, and you have that, you know, burning desire to get back. And you know, look, you know, James were riding the horses, but he was one of the first person to call me when I was in America. So, yeah. You know, it's a real good, you know, people come together when things like that happen.
Sure.
And it's nice to see.
And James, you know, he did a fantastic job to get back in 3 months, didn't he?
Unbelievable.
Two months.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say.
A Breeders' Cup winner in 3 months,
yeah.
Which is quite unbelievable.
It is.
But I mean, you know yourself, it is something, isn't it? Not only the physical side of it, the mental side of it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I'm not quite to William's level, but I was obviously out, had a bad fall in Australia earlier on in the year, and that put me out for 7 weeks. It took me to get back, and like William says, it's amazing how everyone, you know, gets behind you, and you know, you can't, you know, you have that burning desire to get back on the track.
And so it spurs you on a bit.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And you almost come back even better than you were before, because you put that where you were, because you're trying that hard to get back in time.
You mentioned Australia. We've got questions coming in from all over. My WhatsApp is buzzing here. We've got Dubai, we've got UK, Europe, and also we've got Australia. Let's start with Australia, with a question in mind. How different was Australia for you, being a European jockey most of your life, all your life, going out there? How much did you have to adapt when you went there?
Yeah, it was so different, Jim. I mean, it was, you know, we'd experienced, both myself and Will had been down before and ridden in the Golden Slipper and ridden in various races, Cox Plate before, so we kind of had a little taste of it. But
it was different, wasn't it?
But to be actually based there for a long period of time, it was pretty tough, because, you know, I was straight in riding, you know, horses that were short in the betting. You know, I think my first sort of 4 or 5 rides were very short in the betting and at tight tracks. I think Canterbury was the first day I rode, and it's not an easy track, as you know. It's very, very tight. You know, it makes Chester look like a galloping track. So, obviously, yeah, it was very different tempo. I mean, gate speed it was obviously vital, and securing a good pitch early on in the race. And yeah, just the tempo of the race, you know, they jump hard from the gates and then they stack up on the turn, and you know, it gets all tactical with lads sort of popping off. You know, if the pace is slow, they start peeling off, and you have to sort of work out whether you should be peeling off or, you know, sucking up. So it's very, very different, but it was a good challenge. It's great to be, it's great to challenge yourself. And I felt, you know, although I found it difficult, I felt I did a pretty good job, or I hope I did, anyway.
Well, I thought you did a pretty good job. You rode four, was it four one day at Randwick?
Yeah, I had a four time at Randwick one
yeah.
day, yeah, which was a good day, yeah.
Well, that was a good day. Well, there'll be a lot of Aussie punters out there watching here, and we hope to a few of you send in a few questions. How good was James Doyle at the end? of his stint there, and how good was he at the start? How much did he improve? That's what we want. That's what we want to know. So just let him get in touch with us. Now the best question that we have will be winning a. The person who's fires in the best question will be winning one of these Godolphin hats, autographed by the lads here. So I hope you'll agree that's something worth firing in a question about. So we'll pick those a bit later. But let's start off with a couple of questions, and a couple from our viewers, and those who are in touch with us. First of all, Gwen from the Godolphin Club, how can you connect with a horse that you have never ridden before, Will?
It's a very good question. You know, we ride probably, in a 12-month period, we probably ride 1,000 different races, maybe a little bit less, say between 800 and 1,000 different races, and a large percentage of those races we have only seen the horse on the replay channels that we can get on the internet. So we have never sat on the horse, we've had no connection with the horse before. But you know, today you have access to so much information online and through the racing websites that you watch all the replays, and you also rely on the trainer's information, what they say, or the assistant trainer's information, and 9 times out of 10 that's good enough. But you can't really beat knowing the horse yourself and having ridden the horse over a period of time. But then also some people say, you know, it's not bad to have a fresh perspective on a horse. So there's plenty of different ways to look at it, but how to get a connection with a horse for the first time, the best thing is just to get on it and ride it. And
so when you go down to the start, say you're at Newmarket, you're going down to the start, 1 1/4, a long way down there. Are you having a little feel as you go down, or not? Is that?
We can't have too much of a feel because you need to save our energy.
Well, exactly. But
it's a good question. It's a brilliant question because it does sound completely crackers, doesn't it? You're going out to ride a horse in a race that you've never seen before, and sometimes, you know, they've never even raced before. So it's a very good question. Like you say, from the minute you get on in the paddock and going to the start, down at the stalls, you're constantly just trying to work them out, see what sort of character they are, and obviously the trainer would have given you the tips on whether they're quicken up or whether they're more of a galloper. So actually riding the race is quite simple. It's just getting to know the horse.
And putting it in perspective, you guys are obviously retained by Godolphin, so you're here riding out many times, which is unlike sort of many other jockeys. But how big a percentage of the rides you have in a year would be non-Godolphin horses, do you think? Would it be 20%, 30%?
I suppose for me it's probably slightly more this year, but I would imagine, for me it would have been 50-50, I would have thought, this year.
Right.
Yeah.
What about you, Will?
Yeah, less. Maybe 20% outside, maybe even less than that. And look, as a retained jockey, your job is to know the horses. And you know, as far as Godolphin horses go, especially in this country, I would like to think that we've been across most of them.
And it's interesting you say you've got to conserve energy, and this is, I think a lot of people don't really realise this. When you're on the gallops, you're not wanting to test them. You're trying to get a feel, but you're actually still got to think of race day. You can't have your race on the gallops, can you?
Yeah, no, you're 100% right. But look, that's why we rely on all the good trainers that we're fortunate enough to work with, and they find that balance. You know, at the end of the day, we're jockeys, we're not the trainers, so it's very important not to interfere with that side of it, but just do what you get asked to do and what you feel is right for the horse.
And James, I've sat in the car with you guys when you come in. It sounds to me sometimes that you. Often horses surprise you on the gallops. I've heard you sit there and say to Charlie, "Well, that found a bit. You know, that's got something."
Yeah, no. I mean, it can happen. You know, the penny drops with them. You can, you know, often I've galloped a horse a few times, and then, you know, the third, fourth time, suddenly the penny really drops, and they find that change of gear, and that they improve. And you know, I think that's what it's all about. Is, you know, Charlie's done a fantastic job this year, and you know, we've had a fantastic flow of 2-year-old winners right through the season, and you know, he's sorted them out very well. And, you know, them ones that are a little bit behind, you know, he's given them a little bit of time. And the ones that have, you know, when they have stepped it up a gear and improved, he's given them a chance. And more often than not, they've gone out and proved him correct.
Right. A question here from Becca Smith on Twitter. How important do you feel it is to have a healthy diet?
Key. I mean, it's key in not just for a sportsman, is it? It's important for life. But for especially for a jockey who's, you know, our weight management is so important. And you know, there's two ways of doing it. There's forcing your body, but there's working with your body. And working with your body, you have a healthy diet, you have a healthy exercise routine. And that helps on every level. And you know, that we have access to a lot of help nutrition wise and exercise wise, but there's nothing better than trial and error, and that comes with experience. So, you know, we've tried various different things, and now we're at the stage now where we've got the right balance, and we've, you know, you feel that what you do at the moment, you'll get longevity from.
Do you agree with that?
Yes. I suppose.
Because you seem to be a little bit taller than Will.
Yeah.
A little bit.
No, it's tough. I do, you know, it's very tough, and I have to be very, very strict with my diet and plenty of exercise. But, I mean, it's very straightforward. But, like Will says, you know, if I think back to how I was trying to manage my weight when I was sort of 17, 18, it's from what I'm, you know, comparing that to what I'm doing now, it's crazy what I think back to what I was doing, you know.
You feel you were clueless when it came to,
yeah,
sort
you're
of
just
dying.
Clueless, yeah, and yeah, probably lacking a bit of respect for your weight, whereas now, you know, I haven't got that big sort of up and down with it like I used to. You know, my weight is pretty constant throughout the season.
Let's see, now we've got another one from Richard Hall on Twitter. What's the best race in the calendar for a jockey?
Say the Epsom Derby.
You haven't won it?
I haven't won it. I've been
second
twice. If you picked the one race, that would be my race anyway.
What do you reckon?
I suppose here, obviously, yeah, you'd have to say the Derby. I haven't even ran in the frame of it yet, unfortunately, but I haven't had that many cracks at the whip. But also the Arc de Triomphe, obviously, in Europe. I mean, I've been fortunate enough to ride in that quite a few times now, and yeah, it's a great atmosphere and obviously a fantastic race to win. Yeah.
How different is it before a race like the Arc or a race like the Derby, in the changing room, in the jockey's room?
Yeah, it's very different. Obviously, it's I think you have to approach it the same as it's like any other race, really. But no, you could, I mean, especially at Epsom, you can certainly feel a difference. You know, it's much more quieter, and the guys are really, really in the zone, and it's quite intense. Same at Royal Ascot throughout Royal Ascot week. It does loosen off, you know, towards the end of the week, but the first few days it's very tense.
So when you win the Queen Anne on Ribchester, you come in
you're laughing,
right?
Oh, but you still have
first
to.
Race
you, I mean, you know, all these big festival meetings. You have to remember and not forget to, you have to enjoy it, because we are fortunate enough to go to these big meetings, big races, with good rides, nice horses, and you know, that's a dream. So although it's very, very intense, and you know, jockeys become all of a sudden they're in the weighing room and they look like poker players, you know, but you have to also remember to enjoy it, because if you do enjoy it, you perform better.
Here's a question from Mark White on Facebook. Who's the most fun in the jockey changing rooms? And I'm presuming that's not during, not pre-Derby.
Jamie Spencer keeps us all on our toes. Yeah. He's good fun. He's always up to tricks, and yeah, he's great bloke to be around. If you know, if you're having a bad day, he'll certainly brighten your day up.
How did you find Australia in the changing room there?
Yeah, I had quite a good corner, actually. I mean, I sat next to Hugh Bowman at pretty much every race meeting, and having met Hugh when he came over here quite a few years ago, and yeah, he's a fantastic bloke, and yeah, he's pretty much the same. You know, he's always on the wind up, and
yeah.
Karen McAvoy is obviously a great guy.
Yeah. Let's see, from Russell Bader on Facebook. What are William's and James's favourite race courses to ride at? William?
Ascot in the UK and Maidan internationally.
I'd have to agree with that, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, been pretty lucky at both places, and I think if you're locked in at a track, you know, it's hard for it not to be your favourite.
Well, the obvious next question, what's the worst?
Say that on live.
Right. You tell us later. Right?
Yeah.
But I mean, there must be sometimes you pick up the pace and oh no, I'm not riding there again. No. All right, okay, we'll leave that one. Luke Harden on Facebook. Are the English ever going to win a test match in Australia this year?
You're talking to the wrong guy. I don't know anything about cricket.
You're Norwegian, yeah. Right? Is that right?
Yeah.
You're pleading Norwegian.
Yeah.
Come on, James.
I wouldn't follow it that much. Yeah. But
you must have got a lot of ribbing down there.
I did a fair bit. Yeah. Didn't understand much of it, but I did get a fair bit of it.
Right, here's one from Kenny Smith on YouTube. What's your best chance of a classic win, first of all, Will, in 2018?
Well, I think obviously...
I'm presuming we're talking about England.
Yeah. I mean, we're going into the winter now, so... You know, now the horses have heavy rugs on them and they're having a quiet time and sort of they're not in full training. So, but look, we finished off the year in good shape. Charlie produced a lot of nice two-year-olds that were not put under any pressure. They came naturally. But, you know, a colt that springs to mind, looking at, you know, a lot can happen over the winter. So, you know, you have to have an open mind, but... I thought when Gayat.
So I have to decline that one.
When Gayat won the Autumn Stakes, he has the pedigree. He's by the Bowie. He has the scope. He has the mentality, and he showed the ability that day when he won the Autumn Stakes, and that was a step up from his maiden win. So his big step up. So he's a colt. And then
just refresh my mind about the pedigree. He's got a great pedigree, hasn't he?
He's by the Bowie, he's out of Nighttime, who's by Galileo, and Nighttime won the Irish Guineas herself. So
that was the Dermot Weld. I think Dermot's mother actually bred and owned the horse. Yeah.
But look, he's got the pedigree, he's got the ability, and let's hope and pray. And as far as fillies go, we had a filly, we have a filly called Magic Lily, who is by New Approach, and she was third in the Fillies Mile. Very much a next year project, look, if any natural progression, she should certainly be a classic candidate as well.
Okay, James?
Probably if Will picks up the suspension or an injury.
You'll be waiting in the wings, right? Yeah.
I'd say Wild Delusion as well, you'd have to mention her. She
Group 1 winner at Shanty.
She improved with each run, and she looks like she could be a potential Oaks candidate.
Yeah, those fillies that Charlie's got, they certainly do progress, don't they? I mean, Wahida, what a revelation she's been, eh?
But I mean, we mentioned three, you know, and there's probably people there thinking, why have you not mentioned other horses, you know? So look, it's...
Throw a couple more in there.
But, you know, we have, you know, as I just said, going into the winter, looking ahead for next year, you know, this is always an exciting time because, you know, you start off the season at the Craven meeting here in Newmarket in April. You know, and you just hope and pray that they've improved and that they are what you have been hoping all winter. So we'll all find out then.
And how many of these horses would actually go that we're talking about? We're talking about classic horses.
Yeah.
How many would actually go to Dubai? Any of them go to Dubai and winter there?
I think another horse that we didn't mention, Glorious Journey, I think he's having a winter in Dubai.
Right.
Obviously, James, you won the Group 3 on him in St. Cloud.
Yeah, he's done pretty well, you know. Took a little bit of time to come to hand, and then after his first win, Charlie gave him a bit of a break to just let him grow and do a bit. And yeah, he won a nice race out in France. And I think there's a few going out. I'm not sure exactly the numbers of how many Charlie's decided to take, but I think there's a few.
We'll tell you on Friday morning when we've seen them ourselves.
That's good. That's good. Yeah, send us a wire back, will you?
Yeah.
Just one here from. Claire Breeden on Facebook. If you could have anything for Christmas, what would it be?
I love Christmas. Well, we have all the food, don't we? So everyone eats well at Christmas, which is a treat for us.
You just told us about your diet.
No, Christmas is Christmas. Really
all right, okay,
no,
right.
No, but anything for Christmas. For everyone to have a nice Christmas.
Well, that's very generous.
Yeah.
Break the mold. Come on.
I don't know. For a wish, I don't know. A good ride in the Derby next year. Be nice.
Yeah. So, I'll ask you one. What is the one race you singly want to win in 2018? You have to pick one race of them all. What would you want to win?
Epsom Derby.
All right.
Derby.
Well, it's going to be a dead heat, is it?
I'd settle for the Arc if he gets a Derby. I'd settle for the Arc.
Right. Okay. Well, listen. Anything else that we should be doing? I think the guys are
finish on a quiz.
No, we've got a quiz. We've got a quiz. And it is.
So the first one is how many each person is going to guess how many wins James has had this season?
Right.
And then it's
okay.
Williams, and then
for the year or for the.
For the Great British and Irish season.
Right, so the way it works, if you're watching, is that the guys, we're trying to find out how much they know about each other. They're great mates. How much do they really know about each other's riding? Now, I've given Will and also James these bits of paper. They've got to put down a number. That is, first of all, you've got to put down the number of James's wins.
Since January.
I think it's from since January.
Since January to December.
So, in Britain.
Okay, so the 12-month period.
In Britain from January the 1st to now.
Does Dubai count? Or Australia?
No, just Britain. Just Britain. So we're just really going to see how much they know, these guys. There's no cheating. It looks like he's written that in.
I'm a bit of a generous, maybe.
I think you're trying to disguise it. Can you write it bigger? Write it bigger.
Sorry, I'm not good at scorching.
That's it. That's what we want. Right. And you got to do. I presume you got to do Will's. You got to do a number for Will.
That's the next one. Do we go there?
Yeah, we'll start with yours.
All right, so you got your number.
Yeah.
Right, okay, Will, first, James's wins. You say 120, right?
103, I reckon.
110.
110, so I'm told by the referee at the back of the room. 110 you're written. Okay, so now we're going to concentrate on William. How many winners has Will Buick ridden in 2017, from January the 1st to today, in Britain? Right, James, how much do you know about Will Buick?
86.
86? W. Buick says? No, 90.
Yeah.
You found four.
It's 80.
Ooh. It's 80. Dear. How can a man be so wrong? How can you be, 12% wrong?
See, I've gone nearly 10 too low. It's gone 10 too high.
I know. It's all we're going to do. Right, I'll take those through. Right, now, we're looking at winning percentages for the year. Now, Will, you say this is your great department, right? This is where you're expecting to excel. James's winning percentage? Okay.
I'm going to say 22%. Will.
Right, what's the answer?
It's 22%.
22%, and is 20% correct?
No, it's 22% is right.
Okay. Yeah, and for... we're going to do Will now, right, sorry. I'll say that.
Yeah.
Right. Mm. The James percentage. How much do they know about each other? 22%.
It is correct. It's also 22%. So you both got the same.
Both 22.
Yeah.
So, well, that's good. Excellent. Well, listen, thanks, guys, for joining us.
Well, thank you, and thank you for all the questions
and,
as well.
Yeah,
thank you, everybody, for joining us on Godolphin this morning. We've really enjoyed it. It's been a bit of fun. It's been great to end the year on a good note, on a high note, and hopefully we'll be talking to you guys a lot more when you're out in Dubai. So thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much, Jim.
Good luck. Have a happy Christmas.
Thank you, Jim.
And thanks for joining us on Godolphin. Hope we can do it again pretty soon.
Thank you, guys. Sorry.
Cool, yeah. Oh. Okay.
Oh, I can't get the stick.